Welcome to the series on key text in social sciences and humanities. And today I'm going to talk about a very important text written by one of our anthropologists, Leela Dube. The name of the book is An Anthropological Explanation of Gender, Intersecting Fields. As we already see from the title of the text, it is trying to give us a very complex and diverse relation between anthropology and gender. But before I go into the text and go into the detail of what we are trying to understand in this very significant text, it is very important to keep in mind the idea behind which, with which we initiated the series called Key Text in Social Sciences and Humanities. And to remind you, we began this series in order to try to understand the significance of the context of production, the context of the circulation of the book, and very important, how the context of reception. And the whole idea of doing a series on trying to understand one single text by anthropologists, sociologists, philosophers, and scholars is to try to understand what should a student keep in mind while reading a text and how we make sense of the biography of an author with the text and also the context in which he or she is writing this. And with that in mind, let me just try to understand who was Leela Dube and why was she writing on an area called gender and kinship. So to begin with, Leela Dube is a renowned anthropologist and a feminist scholar, and among the feminist circles she is fondly called as Leela D. This is a tradition with calling back from the 70s in the women's movement, where senior elderly women were referred as the, meaning elder sister. So, see, because he had a very significant place in the field of activism as well as academy, he was quite familiar and friendly among all. Leela Dube was born on 27th March 1923 as a fourth child in a Brahmin family. Now, this context of being born in a Brahmin family, it helps us to try to understand also the time when she was growing up. Is a time when gender of women's issue was a kind of a concern in Indian society, and also at the same time when she'll grow up and the period when she starts writing is a time when the women's movement is also nurturing both in the West and the Indian context. So this has to be kept in mind when we read the text. Her father worked in the state judicial of Central Province. Now, this is very important because this was a time when Western education, English education was introduced in the country, and a large number of middle class Indians would have taken advantage of the system of education just to get a job in the administration. And once you got a job in the British administration, it was kind of a progressive sign. So, she was lucky enough to be born in a family which was trying to be on an economic financial stability. She journeyed from modern urban family through modern school and college education to become a pioneer in women's studies. So, at a time when not many women were being, or girls were not being able to go to school, and women's education was in a bad kind, not many women were lucky enough to be able to go to schools. She was being successful in going through higher education and completing her PhD. So that again becomes the backdrop against which she is being able to try to problematize the issue of gender and its relation in the Indian society. When we look into her education, she started her academic career, that is, she started her teaching at in 1960 at Sagar University, Madhya Pradesh. She shifted to Delhi in 1975, where she assigned a key role in shaping towards equality report of the Committee on the Status of Women in India. And this was a report, which was a committee which was set up in order to find out the role or the conditions of status of women in the Indian context and how much the process of development was actually benefiting women. This becomes a breaking point in her career because this gave her a very significant role, and this is when she realizes that gender issue has to be addressed in the if it has to be corrected or it has to be some amount of reformulated. She was one of the pioneer and a senior faculty at Institute of Rural Management, Anand, when it started in functioning in 1980. So we see that her entry into anthropology is completely a little later because she has actually graduated in Sanskrit, philosophy, English, and completed her master's from Nagpur University. Her interest shifted to anthropology after marrying S.C. Dube. We all know that S.C. Dube is a renowned anthropologist. She started her research on Gond women in Chhattisgarh on his suggestions and finished her PhD in anthropology from Nagpur University in 1953. When we look into her achievement and award, she has served on several boards, including chairperson of the Commission on Women on International Union of Anthropological and Ethnological Sciences from 1976 to 1993. She held several fellowships at ICSSR, Teenmurthy, Center for Women's Development Studies, and among others. She received the UGC National Swami Pranavanda Saraswati Award in 2005 and Lifetime Achieve Award. When we look into the whole idea of why we need to look into her achievement and award is to bring us back to the whole idea that the scholar is actually rooted in the work or the area where one is working, and therefore it is from those learning which through which the work actually takes shape. When we look into the context in which she started writing the text, we see that she drew a lot of inspiration from kind of different phase things that were happening simultaneously. We know she was growing up at a time of colonial rule in India, and there was a lot of changes which was taking place at the administrative level in the and social reforms were taking place. The second happening which was taking place was in terms of the strong emergence of the nationalist movement against the colonial rule, and in the history of the colonial rule and the nationalist movement, we've seen that the women, especially from the middle class, played a very dominant role. And it was also a movement which is actually trying to figure out the whole debate between the private and the public and the domestic space which was allotted to women. She began her work at a time when neither anthropology nor women's studies was taken seriously by mainstream society. And this becomes very crucial for us to understand a text as complex as anthropological explanation, because if in the 1950s and early 1960s, we see that both anthropology in Indian context was in a nurturing state, and there was not much attempt to be trying to understand what was being done to the women's studies. And women's studies was also emerging. Leela Dube played a very important role in bringing women's studies to social sciences and in the mainstream society. It is because we know that the time that she was growing up, the time that she was receiving her education, as well as the time when she was doing academic work, it was a difficult time for any women to actually go ahead and talk about women, her status in society, talk about marriage and sexuality. But she was a woman who bypassed her time, and she tried to actually talk about many a things which was not being talked about. But then we don't try to go with the assumption that she was becoming a writer who was completely involved in one role of a feminist. But she was one person who was trying to balance both her feminist writing and her activism along with being a good homemaker. She was one of the first generation women ethnographers to study the impact of caste, kinship, cultural moorings on the girl child. And the reason why it is important to understand that she's one of the first Indian women ethnographer was to try to understand the difficulties faced by a woman or a young woman to go to the field and actually do participant observation and collect data. And in one of her pieces in EPW, she does a self-reflection and tries to analyze the problems that she underwent while doing the field work in different parts of the country. But then these hurdles or these obstacles did not stop her from going ahead and going and doing a lot of ethnography. Dube drew affinity to women's issue much before the second wave feminism took roots in India. The ethnographer in her emerged during her childhood experience of growing among a large network of relatives. So this is very significant because it's a person who is being born up in a society which is kind of a gendered imbalance, plus is growing up in an environment there are a large number of relatives, and is a time when anthropology was trying to come up with theories which was trying to understand descent, inheritance, and property. So this growing up in itself was kind of a lesson which she was trying to explore through her academic writing. The desire to look at gender critically was a result of the concern of caring mother who believed that C and four sisters got settled in a final family. So, and this is something which is mentioned in her writings, that while she was growing up, she was very concerned, her mother was very concerned that all her sister got settled in the got married and got settled. But then the mother was also at the same time concerned about the other side of the story in terms of what happened if they were not able to get a good final relation. So this is what actually was working behind her mind that prompted her to take up an issue as complex as gender, feminism, women's, patrilineal society, socialization, gender construction, and try to problematize them and try to arrive at an analysis that would help us to understand the Indian society. In her analysis, she drew much from her own life as from researching the other. She accepted only that for her, the subject of women was an emotional concern converted into an intellectual challenge. So again, here we see in anthropology, there was a lot of debate between studying the self and studying the other. There is kind of a dichotomy between the self and other. But here we see that she's trying to do away with these differences and try to say that you learn as much from your own life as much you learn while you are studying other society. And this brings us to her methodology which she was using in terms of in her exploration, and that is a comparative method, that he was trying to compare different types of societies. He's comparing a kind of a North Indian patrilineal society with a kind of other society which are matrilineal and bilateral. She accepted openly that when we are trying to do a dichotomy in terms of private, public, emotional, reasoning, these are all dichotomy which was coming in from sociology in terms of trying to do a distinction between the two world of femininity and masculinity. But here is a young woman who is trying to do away with all these differences and distinctions, and she's trying to analyze that one is to be found in the other as much as the other is in one. The person, anthropologist and feminist, were in continuum. So this is very significant, that who you are, what you are doing and what you advocate are not different dimensions of one's personality, but they go hand in hand together, and it is interrelated to each other. As early as 1975, she had written reflexively about the impact of fieldwork, age, gender and location on fieldwork. That is, a researcher, when he or she enters a field, does not get isolated from what who he or she is, what is the gender of the person, how will the person negotiate the gender or with the problem that is being investigated. And these are something which is very integral. Self-reflection is very important in a kind of any kind of an ethnographical research. When we look into her contribution, we see she was one of the most important figures in the 1970s of the Indian Sociological Society. And we look into her contribution, we can categorically talk about her contribution in three broad framework. First was that she was... she elaborated the discipline of anthropology by introducing women's studies into it. And there we see that anthropology till the 1960s, maybe when we look into the Western anthropology, kind of there was a kind of a male bias in anthropology. Whether we look into Ratcliffe Brown's studying of the African society, where he's trying to trace the line of descent through the male ego, to Malinowski studying the Trobriand and Island and trying to focus only on men in the economic transaction and neglecting women. And then also we look into Levi-Strauss trying to understand alliance and marriage as exchange of women. Here is an anthropologist who is trying to bring about a significant aspect of kinship studies, and that is integrating gender into it. And that's how the entire discipline of anthropology got expanded. At the second level, we see she introduced women's studies, and where when we are trying to understand gender, we are trying to understand socialization, we are trying to understand inheritance, property, she is trying to expand on the idea that women's study is very significant in terms of understanding any kind of kinship structure. At the third level, she tried to understand that she was trying to add to the entire women activism by trying to show that the Indian hierarchical society was not kind of isolated, but they were kind of related, and there was a complex relation between gender, caste, class and religion. She played a crucial role in the 1984 World Sociological Congress, in which activists and women studies scholars played a dominant role through the Research Committee of Women in Society. In the World Sociological Congress in 1984, Leela Dube was the chair of a session on research committee called Women in Society, and she chaired a session on declining sex ratio in Indian society. And it was through her contribution, the way she tried to focus on the declining sex ratio due to the high level of son preference in India. It was a kind of a time when nobody in the Western context were trying to understand a complex problem of declining sex ratio. Leela Dube research is fundamental to the study of women, Indian women, because she probed the womanhood more intently than anyone. And when we go into the book, we see that how intentionally she's trying to understand women, not only in terms of the domestic sphere, but she's trying to understand how the asymmetry in the domestic sphere is actually by and large responsible for the inequality in the productive sphere. So that is very integral to kind of, or a very integral contribution to the way in which women's studies got mainstream in the Indian context. Besides the book that we are dealing today, Leela Dube has written extensively on many other issues. Some of her other works are Women, Work and Family in 1990 in the series on Women and Household, Structures and Strategies, co-edited with Rajni Palriwala, the co-edited volume Visibility and Power, Essays on Women in Society and Development, along with Ellen Leacock and Shirley Ardener, published in 1986. The volume provides international perspective on anthropology of women in the context of socio-political setting of India, Iran, Malaysia, Brazil and Yugoslavia. So we see that she's not trying to only limit herself in the terms of understanding what it was happening in India, but all this I'm trying to compare it with other countries and to try to understand that whole idea of universalizing the understanding of patriarchy as being uniform and universal is incorrect, and this is a perspective which was coming in from the Western anthropology. The seminal essay by Leela Dube on socialization of Hindu girls in patrilineal India brings out this facet in each rich detail. The lives of women are thus shaped and informed by the cultural understanding of women, and here it is very important to try to understand her methodology, and we'll see that she was constantly using the everyday language, the idioms, the rituals, customs, ceremonies which are taking place, and it is through the analysis of the everyday cultural life of individuals that she's trying to arrive at an kind of a hierarchical society in which, due to certain understanding, due to certain assumptions, women are considered as subordinate. And she's using lots of everyday idioms which is being used, and in one of her texts she's making reference to a kind of a word like nurturing or socializing girls in Indian family is like watering a plant in someone else's courtyard. This is important to understand that this in itself, proverb itself implies the way in which the women or girls in Indian society are considered as paraya dhan, or someone who is not the part of her family in which is born. And then she will take this up later in her analysis of matrilineal society, where she is going to do a comparison between the patrilineal society and a matrilineal society. She differences the notion of femininity from the concept of femininity, and this is very important because the concept of femininity is mostly coming in from the Western feminist scholarly writing, where femininity kind of a social construction or attributes assigned to the female sex. But here it is important to understand the concept of femininity, which is important that it is a concept of women's self-identification at a structural level. Who I am, it is a significance of women's agency, not what others are saying who you are, but your self-realization of who you are, what is your role in society, And that becomes very significant in terms of trying to understand women's agency from a structural process. And then she's trying to see that this is a process which is not at a kind of one time or something which is happening haphazardly, but it is a process which emerges through a cyclical process. And that is, if you look into the life cycle rituals of women, and we see that how gender negotiations in the entire rituals or rites of passage is very significant in terms of young pre-puberty girls being allowed to be more open or trying to more kind of mobile or free. But once the pre-puberty rituals are held, then there's cultural norms of restricting the mobility and women's move, entire identity of women becomes more strict. Then what is very important to understand, because it's an anthropological text, it is important to understand the field work, and she's one of the pioneers in trying to introduce the field work from a feminist perspective and also trying to reflect on the way in which she carried out her field work, the obstacles she faced, and how one should go about doing one's field research. She has done several field work, but here we'll focus on only some of her important work. The first three important field work that she had carried out was the first doctoral field work experience from Gond women in the 1940s. And second is a field work in village in western Uttar Pradesh in 1950s to access women's response to government sponsored community development programs. And her third field work is work on matrilineary and Islam in Lakshadweep in 1970s. So we see that each of these research or field work is kind of a progressive, and she would actually kind of become more into kind of a more progressive kind of an analysis from 1940s to 1970s. Field work in Central India, 1947 to 50s, she was a young woman trying to find out a space in male-dominated society. So 1950s would have been a little difficult for a young researcher to go to a tribal area and kind of collect data. And there's a lot of situations, times where she was not taken seriously, or people would just laugh off of her, and people would think that she's just kind of doing it just because she is kind not very, she has no other work to do it. It was not taken very seriously. But however, the advantage for her to carry out this field work was that she received a lot of support from her father-in-law. And the second very important from a research perspective is that the experience of earlier female researcher and the failures as a learning experience. She was well versed with what were the experiences of researchers or by women who had gone through it, and she's trying to overcome those researchers and research obstacle and ensure that it doesn't happen in her own field work. In her field work, she used unconventional materials such as folk tales, folk songs, proverbs, legends, and myths. And at this time in 1950s, when we don't have much literature in terms of anthropological theory, and there is a kind of a structured way of doing field work, she is becoming more exploratory, and she is trying to understand society not through a structured questionnaire or interviews, but exploring the everyday life of individual and trying to understand the tribal societies. She is looking into the folktales, songs, proverbs, and these proverbs, folktales has become a rich source of anthropological research in the recent time. Her second experience was of a research assistant to her anthropologist husband in North India. Here she explores both complementary of her roles and constraint phase due to age, gender, caste on her research. She was able to differentiate between an insider and an alien. In anthropology, there's a lot of trying to understand that when we go into a field, there's a kind of a researcher is considered as an outsider, someone who is coming from outside to explore the cultural life of people who are living in one community, and they are termed as insider. And there's always a kind of a conflict between the insider and outsider. And a lot of literature, research text would actually provide guidelines in terms of ways in which an outsider could turn up to take the role of an insider. But here we see Leela Dube much earlier than these theories and literature trying to grapple with the problem of insider and outsider. The learning helped her in the third field work, where she was outsider to the Muslim Lakshadweep but established a relationship through her research. So again, we see that if we keep in mind in terms of the rich contribution that she has been doing to anthropology, is basically she is trying to do away with the distinction or the dichotomies which has been there. So the insider, outsider, there's a very thin line, and if it is on the art and the skill of a researcher to cross that insider to become of an outsider to become an insider, and then to explore the society as one's own society. She had become interested in the Lakshadweep, a group of islands in the Arabian Sea off the coast of Kerala, as a result of student of her doing his MA and then PhD research on marriage and kinship practices among the islander. She was quite impressed by the data collected by her student and therefore decided to go on and do a full-fledged research on her own. And the article, Who Gains from Matrilineal, is a result of her research work in the Lakshadweep island. From her writing, it is clear that these questions also emerged from an interest evoked both by her personal experience of marriage, of living her life in a North Indian patrilineal context, and from her deep interest and methodological commitment to the comparative method. So we need to keep these things in mind, her own growing up, experience of growing up in a gendered patrilineal, patrilocal family in North India, and at the same time her deep concern to the field that she belonged and to discipline that she was, and that is trying to understand, actually raise a question that whether these, what is happening in her society is something which is specific to her culture, or is it something which is found in other society, and therefore she was trying to understand through a comparative method. She delicately identifies her location as a researcher who is a Brahmin, married and employed, and the impact that has on her data gathering and interaction with the groups she visited. So this is very important, the self-location of a researcher when he or she visits the field. And that is why when we look into her writings, we see that she was most of the time trying to collect data from the Brahmin family and a Hindu family. So a kind of a critical assessment could be that this is not looking into the other non-Brahminical society, and could be that this is an analysis based on the understanding of only a partial society. But then it is very important to understand that this is the identity of a researcher helps one to kind of study a society which one is familiar to. In Lakshadweep, she found herself having greater freedom in movement, and notes that because of the religious difference, there was some initial skepticism regarding her kumkum or sindoor, which is the mark or symbol which married women in North India wear. And removing it had a desirous effect of free conversation. So when we look into the details of the research, we'll see that Lakshadweep society was a Islamic society, and the whole idea of a woman wearing a sindoor identifies as a Hindu. So the Muslim or the Islamic men would not, women would not interact or not converse freely. So just by removing a symbol that she was wearing, it made her to actually bridge the gap between the insider and the outsider. In Uttar Pradesh, in the research or the fieldwork in Uttar Pradesh, she was expected to conform to certain patterns of behavior of being a Brahmin. And again, in sociological, anthropological theories of gender and kinship, we see that certain gender norms or certain questions of pati or husband being like a god, pati parmeshwara, some of the rich norms of genders are more strictly followed in a Brahmin society, in a North India Brahmin society. So a researcher many a time has to take on the role of the community which you are studying, and this is what was expected out of her, that she would confirm the gender norms. But through confirming the gender norms is also questioning why one is following these gender norms. In three different field situations, Leela Dube had to negotiate her caste, marital and religious identity. Her research reflects the gendering of the field and the self-reflection as a researcher. Her work mentions of her experience in the field, reactions and responses from respondents to her femininity. How people were kind of giving response to a woman and a Brahmin woman moving out of her four corners of the household and moving to a tribal belt or to other society and trying to explore. So there was a lot of negativity to her, but she was able to overcome that and do her research. Now, finally, we'll come to the book, which is Anthropological Exploration of Gender and Intersecting Field. This is basically a work covered over 50 years of life. This is a collection of 6 essays written from the period of 1975 to 1996. And these different essays, which is a part of this book, have been published in different journals and chapters of books in different period of time. The preface to the book is written by Kamala Ganesh, an anthropologist, who situates Leela Dube's work against the backdrop of historical and contemporary gender studies, something which we have already looked into in the introduction section. In this book, Leela Dube explores the complex and diverse relationship between gender and other axes of stratification like caste, class, and religion. And that is very significant to trying to theorize gender in the Indian context. Is then something like caste was considered to be a simple fourfold division of the stratification of the society, in which women were just as a part of the fourfold division. But here in her article on gender and caste, Leela Dube shows us how gender or women plays a dominant role in maintaining caste hierarchy, maintains a very significant role in maintaining the boundaries between two different castes as well as the hierarchy of the caste system. She brings out the significant role of kinship organization in determining structures of power and gender asymmetry. The first essay in the book is The Women's World, 3 Encounters. This essay is basically a review of her field experience and her narrative of the ethnographic fieldwork which she carried out in the three different fields, and she's giving us a gendered view of anthropology. It reflects an analysis of her precarious position as a woman and anthropologist, tracking down unknown culture from a women's perspective. On her first fieldwork among Gond women in Chhattisgarh region, Dube faces a cultural shock. The middle class view of the man-women relationship have no parallels in the tribal community, and this becomes a very huge challenge for a researcher, because the entire cultural setup of a middle class Brahmin women would be different from a tribal society, and this is a Brahmin women going to explore a tribal society. So how does one cope up with the cultural differences in terms of arriving at a holistic understanding of a society? Accessing information under such circumstances is always an upheaval task, especially because cross-cultural exchange requires identification and empathy from both ends. And this is very important, like until and unless the researcher is able to draw a kind of empathy with the respondent, the research will not be very successful. So you need to keep in the minds the cultural belief of the community to which one goes to explore, and this has to be negotiated, the identities has to be negotiated in order to come out with any kind of a research, and Leela Dube was able to do this in a very successful manner. Dube relates easily to the societal norms of the region she visits by presenting herself as what she is, a woman, a wife, and a mother. So the three roles that I had already spoken about, the person, the anthropologist, and the feminist, she is being able to maintain a balance in the three roles throughout her career, from her education to her becoming a kind of a keeper, feminist, and an anthropological writer. During her subsequent trip to Rajput village in Uttar Pradesh and the Lakshadweep Islands, she emphasizes these aspects to develop a personal bond with inquisitive strangers she meets. So respondents are treated as strangers, as others or outsiders, the responses will not be helpful for research. So it's very important to kind of develop an emotional relation with the respondent or the community that one is researching, and therefore this again becomes a very important feminist contribution to trying to do field work or do ethnographic research. The second essay in the book is on the construction of gender. In this essay, she tries to portray the everyday life of girl and women in Hindu patrilineal household. She examines rituals, songs, ceremonies, and other practice which helps in determining the religious cultural aspect of defining gender relations and gender role. And one of a very important way in which she does it, that she is trying to do a kind of analysis of ceremonies, rituals, which every individual common man can understand. And in trying to understand gender construction, she gives reference to the Durga Puja or Gauri Puja, where Gauri or the wife of Shiv is trying to go to her maternal house for, and it is here where Shiv is trying to deter her from going, and on the context that their son Ganesh is belongs to a rich luxurious lifestyle and would create problem for Gauri's mother parents because they were economically not well off. What is the idea behind taking examples from mythologies, from ceremonies, is to try to bring out the idea that gender was a part of everyday cultural practices in North Indian family. An analysis of kinship is necessary for understanding family ideology. At the time of his writing in anthropology and in sociology, family was considered to be a society which was kind of responsible for socialization, for trying to bring down the cultural pattern, and there was not much theorization of to look into the idea that family could be a place from where inequality begins. And this is a contribution of Leela Dube. VC tries to say that through the process of socialization, girls are taught to be or to accept the subordinate status in society. Her essay provides insight into how women are central to boundary maintenance between castes through regulation control over their sexuality. She explores how the patrilineal Indian society shapes women into a gendered product. And here the reference to patrilineal society, a patrilineal society is a society in which the line of descent is through a male line. And there is a kind of a relation between a patrilineal society and the mode of residence. So a patrilineal society, the mode of residence is a patrilocal or a virilocal residence. The patrilocal means the residence with the father, virilocal residence implies a residence with the husband. So in large part of North India, which is a patrilineal society, we see that women have to leave or the residence of the maternal house and move to the residence of the husband or husband's family, which is also known as the unity of the patrikin. But now the whole idea of residence, change of residence, is then trying to root it to the whole idea of trying to understand women as parayadhan. That since you do not have a space in your own maternal house, you are supposed to move out. And from here only emerges the idea that therefore the women are considered to be a burden on the family in which they are growing. So the metaphoric reference to nurturing or growing up girls is like watering a plant in another's courtyard. It makes reference to the kind of a gender norm which is part of everyday life in any North Indian society. She makes a lot of use of metaphoric language, proverbs, nursery rhyme, demarcating separate zones for men and women. And if we do a very close cultural analysis of the way in which social life itself is organized, we see there's a clear-cut compartmentalization of men and women. And this is again coming in from the cultural beliefs and ideology which has been passed down from one generation to another. The third essay, which is on the seed and earth, and here she is using the metaphor seed and earth to try to understand the subordinate position of women in society. The seed and earth is symbolic of the semen in men and earth as the womb of the women. And what is the significance of the metaphor seed and earth is this is trying to understand that the way in which in the field or in agriculture, the quality of the field will determine the quality of the product. So it is the field which is, I'm sorry, the quality of the seed will determine the quality of the product. So men providing seed provides the are more responsible or doing a more dominant role than the field, which is the earth. So, and also in terms of trying to understand the sexual asymmetry, she's saying that through this metaphor of seed and earth, we try to understand the two important things. One, the subordinate position of women in society, and two, that what is happening in the process of reproduction gets transgressed into the field of production. How is that? Because the women have a subordinate position in the society, it gets translated into the kind of through inheritance, property, and distribution of resources. The whole idea that in the production reproduction process, women have a inferior role because they're just providing the field. So from there, it gets transferred into the denial of right in property, the denial of right in the domestic sphere, and denial of right into resources of the society. So the entire sexual asymmetry is attributed to the metaphor seed and earth. So men is seen as providing the seed for sowing, and the women is the earth or the soil in which the seed is sown. The nature of the crop, offspring, child depends largely on the seed, which is the most important contribution, while the earth provides nutrition to the seed. Traces the origin of metaphor in Vedic text, and that is where she comes out that this is not something which is but the reference to seed and earth has been a part of the history of India, in terms of the reference being found in Manusmriti, in terms of being found in Mahabharata, Ramayana. But what is difference in terms of what is being found in the epics and the ethnographic writing is that in the Vedic text and in the epics, the reference was more on terms of trying to highlight the reproductive role of the women, that the entire agency of women was limited to her reproductive role. Whereas in the ethnographic text, we see how the reference is in terms of structuring the relation between man and women. The ethnographic studies points out that the metaphor was common not only among the Hindu but also practiced among other rural Muslims. Though it is found in many societies, its implication of society has to be examined in material and context of particular society, because the meaning which we assign to the seed and the earth, or whose role is more important, the male or the female role, changes from society to society. For instance, in Punjabi kinship structure, we see the in terms of the seed being of the men, and therefore the blood of the man is transferred into the child, whereas in a kind of a matrilineal society, it is believed that the blood of the child is the blood of the women, and therefore in a matrilineal society, the reproductive role of women is highlighted, and that explains why status of women in matrilineal society is better than what is in the ethnographic society. We go into the fourth essay, which is the essay on what happened to matrilineal. Well, this is a study of the kinship and gender in the matrilineal society in Lakshadweep. This society was a society which was initially a Hindi society. It gets converted into Islamic society, but despite the conversion into Islam and customary laws of Islam, lot of cultural practices, those related to kinship and gender, were very similar to a matrilineal society. This essay, Who Gains from Matrilineal, is basically an explanation or an investigation of how the gender asymmetry is based on the biological difference between man and women. That is, again to repeat, the reproductive role of women gets transferred into the productive space where women are attributed a lower status. The focus here is on Lakshadweep Island, which blends a close-knit matrilineal hierarchy with Islam. Dube contends that the two disparate concepts, Islam and matrilineal, balance each other and provide material security to both men and women. And then that is what is very important, is that by and large is trying to explain that how, despite of religious differences, what would happen in a Hindu matrilineal and an Islamic society is by and large dependent on the kinship structure. So a gender asymmetry is directly linked to the kinship organization of the society. It looks at how a matrilineal structure functions within a religion and marked by patrilineal emphasis. Women in this community yield considerable power as originator of lineage, but matrilineal related men manage property and the more visible decision makes in public. What is very important to try to understand here is to try to understand one major difference which is brought out is between the matrilineal society and a patrilineal society. In a matrilineal society, the line of descent is through female. But there is a kind of a matrilineal puzzle, because what happens that though the line of descent passes through female, the authority or the power passes into a man's hand. So it is the mother's brother or sister's son who becomes the managers of the property, and they are basically in matrilineal society known as Karnavar. But what is important is that in a patrilineal society, the patriarch is the dominant role. He has absolute control over women's mobility and her sexuality. But the Karnavar cannot be compared to a patriarch. The Karnavar only has the manager or has management kind of a rule. He does not have absolute power over women's reproductive power role, nor over her domestic sphere. So that kind of an understanding has emerged only through her research work in the matrilineal society in among the Lakshadweep. There is a marked sexual division of labor present here as well. Women lead qualitatively more autonomous life than ones with a patrilineal system of South Asia. And this again, we try to understand that why is women having more autonomy, why is women having more freedom, is to trace back to the pattern of descent, because it's a line which is through the female, and more important is in terms of the denial of the absolute power to men, that the status of women becomes much better. Women in matrilineal and bilateral society enjoy better status than in a patrilineal society, and Leela Dube has identified 5 spheres in which these dominant status of women emerges. Number one is line of descent. So in a patrilineal society, it is the male line of descent which becomes significant. On the contrary, in a matrilineal society, it is the female line becomes significant. Residence, I already said that in a patrilineal residence, the patrilineal line of descent, the residence is patrilocal, whereas in a matrilineal line of descent, the residence is matrilocal, that is residence with mother's group or residence with wife's group. What is significant here is that these shifting status or the temporary status of women gets changes into a permanent status of women. So in a matrilineal society, the men do not have a permanent status. So they are visiting husbands. Among the Nayar, they have the practice of visiting husband, where the men only goes to the wife house for meeting purpose, and then he returns back to his mother house. Now this giving the residence to one's gender becomes significant in terms of understanding the dominant role of that gender. The third is inheritance. Now when the line of descent is patrilineal and the residence is patrilocal, the inheritance is in the line of the male. So in North Indian society, in the ancient times we had the law of Mitakshara and the law of Dayabhaga. According to Mitakshara, all male members born into a family are co-parsoners. Co-parsoners, that is, by virtue of their birth, they become inheritance of property. So now the Property Act has incorporated the rights of the daughters, but then there is again a kind of a different dispute where women do not claim the right to inheritance over customary practices and other kinds of conflicting relation between the husband and the brother. In a matrilineal society, the line of inheritance is through the female line. So it is the daughters who inherit the property of their. So this kind of again gives them a dominant position. The fourth is ownership of domestic space. Now, when the residence itself is matrilocal, women are not supposed to move out from the maternal house to their marital house. So there is no difference between the daughter-in-law and daughter. In North Indian society, we see a lot of difference between a daughter and a daughter-in-law, and lot of conflict in terms of norms that are assigned to daughters and daughter-in-law. In matrilineal society, we do not see any difference between a daughter and a daughter-in-law, because women belong, the domestic space belongs to the women. And the fifth is in terms of the control, and the control where in a matrilineal society, men have absolute power over women because of their ownership of residence, because of ownership of right to inheritance, and ownership of domestic sphere, which gives them the right to control the sexuality of the women. And so when the last essay in the book is Kinship and Gender in Southeast Asia, the last essay is account of a comparative perspective of kinship system, and this is basically understanding of three types of kinship system. One is the patrilineal society, the second is the matrilineal society, and the third is a bilateral society. And by comparing the norms of gender and the kinship organizations, is trying to understand the gender asymmetry is different in different types of society, and it is the kinship organization that actually results into kind of a gender asymmetry. She concludes that matrilineal and bilateral kinship systems offer women more autonomy than the matrilineal way of kinship. In patrilineal society, as I have already said, the line of descent determines the line of control and authority. So the line of descent is through male have control over the property, line of inheritance is through male, and because they have control over the property, by default they have control over the sexuality and mobility of women. Everything is happening in the male line. Whereas in a bilateral society, it could be either through the male line or through the female line. So in this society, we'll see that the norms of descent is not fixed, the norms of residence is not fixed. So it could be a kind of in a bilateral society, after marriage, it could be the individual couples go on, set up their own houses. So the permanent residence is neither given to female nor to the male, both are kind of a temporary. So a bilateral society becomes more kind of egalitarian compared to a patrilineal and a matrilineal society. Dube's comparative study of the position of women in South Asian countries like India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, with Southeast Asian countries like Thailand and Malaysia, shows that gender asymmetry is dependent on kinship structure. Control over women in matrilineal society is less marked as compared to patrilineal society. Bilateral society is much more egalitarian compared to society with unilineal descent. And the South Asian sense of right over sexuality and the reproductive capacity of in-marrying women are closely tied to the sense of common agnatic blood, to patrilineal, patri-villi-local family solidarity, which is briefly referred as the unity of the patri-kin, and to the understanding that the women now belongs to the family. So this is a statement taken directly from her text to show the significance of the work that she is doing in terms of trying to understand a complex system like kinship organization and try to link it up to in terms of the gender asymmetry or the unequal status. But then she is also trying to say that in a bilateral society which is more gender egalitarian, there are other problems that crop up, and because there is the norms and rules are more open and free in a bilateral society, there could be a issue of other problems. And so these restrictions on premarital sex are laid down for both men and women. In Thailand, women are involved in prostitution or in other kind of sex work because of the entire there is no restriction or no taboos in terms of which could be found in unilineal descent. So we try to see the contribution of Leela Dube. We see that her books has raised an important question for further feminist research, because she's laying down the basis of the foundation of trying to understand society from a feminist perspective and trying to understand the power and structure of society from a women's lens. I hope I have been able to convey the ideas and message as discussed by Leela Dube in her book Anthropological Exploration of Gender, Intersecting Field. With this, I come to an end to today's lecture. Thank you.